गौरचंद्रायुरारिकायतरे कृष्णाय कृष्णभक्ताय तारभक्ताय नमो नमः। आनंदलीलामय विग्रहाय हेमपतिव्यचारिसुंदराय तस्मै महाप्रेमरसप्रदाय चैतन्यचंद्राय नमो नमः। चैतन्यचंद्राय नमो नमः। चैतन्यचंद्राय नमो नमः। Worshipable spiritual Gurudev, Asmati Paramanadatam Guru Pada Padma, Nitilila Pravisht Om Vishnupad, Ashtotarasatasi Rupa Nugacharyavarya, Sila Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj. Secondly, I offer my pranam at the lotus feet of my Guru's Guru, to Srila Prabhupada and all of our Sri Rupa Nuga Gaudiya Guru Parampara. And finally, for my pranam to all the assembled Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis, Panchakalpaturvis, Kapasanga Vyavata, Mudhitanam Pavani, Guru Vaishnavi, Vyonamunam.
Shri Gurudev, Shri Prabhu, Shri Prabhu Ki!
By the causes much of Sri Gurangaranga, today we are celebrating the Divine Appearance Day of Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur. Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur ki jai! He is a very important personality in our Gaudiya Sampradaya, because on this day in the village of Mahamgachi, in the island of Moda Drumadweep, in Navadweep Dham, Narayani, the niece of Srivast Thakur, gave birth to Vrindavan Das Thakur. And as he grew up, he had the great fortune to become the direct disciple of Nityananda Prabhu. And being empowered by Nityananda Prabhu, he manifested Sri Chaitanya Bhagavat. Sri Chaitanya Bhagavat is the first very important biography of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, written in very simple language, in Bangla, in the vernacular. And Srila Vrindavanadas Thakur is considered to be, in Gauralila, the incarnation of Srila Vyasadeva. So just as Srila Vyasadeva manifested the pastimes of Sri Krishna in Srimad Bhagavatam, so Srila Vyasadeva appeared again as Vrindavanadas Thakur and manifested the Chaitanya Bhagavat, the pastimes of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, Srivas Thakur had a brother named Sri Nalina. Sri Nalina. And Sri Nalina's daughter was named Narayani. Once a rumor came to Navadvip, oh, the Muslim king is coming with so many soldiers, in two boats full of soldiers, and they're coming here, they're going to destroy the village. Because this Nimai Pandit, he's making everyone do kirtan. And the smarta brahmanas, kamakanda brahmanas, tantrics and others who are against bhakti have complained to the king that, oh, they may be making one revolution of Hindu nationalism. So everyone was afraid. They were packing their things and getting to trying to leave. Nimai Pandit was dressed in a, decorated in a beautiful garland and sandalwood paste. He was chewing some tambul and strolling on the bank of the Ganga. Everyone was panicking, running here and there. Some people criticized, oh, who does he think he is? He thinks he's a prince. And he's made this problem for us. And as Nimai was walking, then he became gripped by a special bhav. I am he! He began chanting, I am he! He thought, oh, because until this point, no one in Navadvip could understand his identity, that he was Supreme Lord Sri Krishna himself. So when everyone was panicking, Srivas Thakur went into his puja room, closed the door, and began to worship Lord Nishingadev. And he was praying to Lord Nishingadev for protection. Then Nimai Pandit came running to Srivas Thakur's house. He kicked open the door and said, I am he! Srivas Thakur was. Yes, please wait. He said, no, you don't understand. I am he! That Lord you are worshipping, that's me! Srivas Thakur, what happened to Nimai? He said, don't worry about anything. Because I am here. The soldiers of the Muslim king, they cannot do anything. Because I am the Paramatma in the heart of everyone. Upadasta, upamantascha. In Gita, Krishna said, I see everything as Paramatma and I permit. If I don't allow something to happen, it cannot happen. So, if I don't allow these soldiers to come in the boats, then it cannot happen. So don't worry. Srivas Thakur was still not convinced. Nimai Pandit said, look, even if the soldiers get into the boats by some miracle and they arrive here, then I'll go to them and I'll say, why do you want to make a disturbance here? This Sankirtan movement is the very best process for everyone. You bring your soldiers, your horses, your elephants, and bring one of your priests from your mosque and get him to recite your holy scripture and see if he can make everyone cry. Tears of love for God. And then when he does that, and nothing happens, then I will say, Hayo! And I'll make all the soldiers cry tears of love. Their horses will cry, the elephants will cry, everyone will cry in Krishna prem. Shiva's Thakur was also very surprised. Nimaiba, listen, you don't believe me? Watch this. Call all your family members. So then Shiva's Thakur called all his family members. So there was the very little girl, 5 years old, his niece, Narayani. Then Mahaprabhu called her. Oh, Narayani, come here. And the little girl came forward and he said, chant the name of Krishna and be filled with love for Krishna. And then the little girl just said, Krishna, Krishna, oh Krishna, and just started crying and fell on the ground and was rolling on the ground in ecstasy. Mahaprabhu said, see, now do you believe me? I can do it. So that was a false alarm, no soldiers came on that day. But it was the first time Mahaprabhu began to manifest his Bhagavata. So when that little girl grew up, she became the mother of Vrindavan Das Thakur. Nimai Pandit used to give his remnants. She, from her childhood, she used to eat the remnants of Mahaprabhu. And it should be understood that the wife of Srivas Thakur is the incarnation of Krishna's nursemaid, wet nurse, Ambika. Mother Yashoda feeds Krishna her breast milk, but if Mother Yashoda is busy, then Ambika will take care of Krishna. And Ambika has a younger sister named Kalimbika. So that Kalimbika has incarnated as Narayani. From Krishna it became Narayani, the mother of Vrindavan Das Thakur. So from his childhood, he grew up surrounded by divine personalities in the holy dham. He received the mercy of Nityananda, so much mercy of Nityananda actually, that he began to manifest the Chaitanya Bhagavat. And he told so much about Mahaprabhu's childhood pastimes, his youth pastimes, all the pastimes in Navadvip, and then how he accepted sannyas and went to Puri, but he did not describe much about the later pastimes. Because he was so overwhelmed with the mercy of Nityananda Prabhu that he started writing about Nityananda Prabhu when it became so many filled with pastimes of Nityananda Prabhu. And because of this, you like Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami, he wrote Chaitanya Charitamrita, explaining all mainly with the emphasis on the later pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Jagannath Puri. So, of course, it was not like a mistake, but it's an expression of his nishtha. How dedicated he is to his Gurudev, and his Gurudev is Akhanda Guru Tattva, the original total Guru Tattva, undivided original Guru. So, he has written how one day Mahaprabhu said to Srivas Thakur, hey Srivas, why do you let this crazy person live in your house? This Nityananda. No one knows where he's from. What is his caste? He's an avadut. His behavior is quite unpredictable. Why do you let him stay in your house? Srivas Thakur said, Yadyapi Nityananda Suribari Jai Tatapi Seyamar Nityananda Rai. Oh, if Nityananda, I see Nityananda Prabhu going into a pub. Understand? Where everyone goes to drink alcohol. If I see him going into wine club, wine bar, or if Nityananda Prabhu even gets married to a Muslim girl, I don't care. Sayama Nityananda Rai, still he is my Lord. He is my everything. I know that Nityananda Prabhu is none different from you. And without the shelter of Nityananda Prabhu, no one can attain your lotus feet. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard this, he became ecstatic. And he jumped up on Srivas Thakur. I said, Srivas, Srivas! And was shaking him. He said, because you have so much faith in my Nityananda, then, without a doubt, not only do you attain Krishna Prem, all your family members attain Krishna Prem, even the dogs in your house will attain Krishna Prem, even anyone who will just say your name, Srivas.
Srivas!
They'll all attain Krishna Prem. So, Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur has so much Nityananda Nishta, and he has expressed that through his description of the pastimes of Mahaprabhu and his associates. One of the main teachings of Chaitanya Bhagavat, Kahari Naninda Kare Krishna Krishna Boli Ajay Chaitanya Se Jinibe Kahale Nindukaha Nahi Kalabhya Sava Shastra Gai Sabara Saman Bhagavata Dharamahai. Very, very important. He said that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is all powerful. He can't be controlled by anyone. But he can be controlled by that person who never criticizes others and continually chants Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. It's so simple. Just chant always, and just one condition: don't criticize anyone. If you feel yourself, stop. Bacho vegan. Don't say anything. My Srila Bhaktanda Vaman Goswami Maharaj used to say, see everything, hear everything, speak nothing. If you want to do bhajan, just like Lord Shiva, Lord Shiva is called Nilakanta. He has a blue throat because he drank the poison from the ocean of milk. But he did not swallow it. He kept it in his throat. He didn't, because Krishna lives in his heart, so he didn't want to swallow it, make the poison go down to the heart. So he kept it in his throat, and he did not spit it out. So the faults of others, the defects of others, they're like poison. So don't let that go in your heart. And also don't spit it out. Be like Lord Shiva, tolerate it. Don't take it into your heart that you don't think about the faults of others and don't speak them to others. Lord Shiva has given this teaching. So Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur put this stress, made this stress, emphasis on this point. Kahari na nindukari Krishna Krishna boli. Don't criticize anyone and chant always. Ninduka nahi kalavya sarva shastakai. All the scriptures say that those who are fault finders, dosha darshis, always having the darshan of the doshas, always looking for the faults of others with 1,000 eyes like Indra. So those persons, they never attain anything good in their life. Because sabara samman bhagavata dharma, hey? The Bhagavad Dharma, the religion of the Bhagavatam, is to respect everyone. So, all pure Vaishnavas, they are Trinada, Bisuni, Chena, more humble than a blade of grass and respectful to everyone. But if we're in the shelter of a Vaishnava, then they may say, don't do this. And see fault and correct us. But it's not their nature to see faults and correct. So if a Vaishnava is correcting us, what does that mean? Krishna Kripa Shakti. Krishna's Kripa Shakti, the mercy of Krishna is coming through him to purify us. Because it's not their nature. So, Vrindavan Das Thakur in Chaitanya Bhagavata, he said that if anyone criticizes the devotees, then I'll kick him in the head. Not once. In the Adikanda, Madhyakanda and Antikanda, in all the three parts, he has said it in different ways, the same thing. If anyone criticizes Vaishnava, I'll kick him in the head. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur, he commented on this. He said that Someone may say, oh, this Vrindavan Das Thakur, he's very aggressive. Such persons, they don't understand his heart, how merciful he is. That when we come to this line of bhakti, now we're so close to attaining our perfection of life. So close. But if we become possessed by some wicked mentality and criticize other devotees, then though we came so close, we'll lose everything. So Vrindavan Das Thakur cannot tolerate that. That this jiva, oh, he was about to become successful. No. Don't kick him in there. And by kicking him, then maybe some sense will come. What am I doing? I came so close to the perfection of my life. What am I doing? So, that is his mercy. If anyone will get the foot dust of Vrindavan Das Thakur on his head, then they must be transformed. So he's written in a very flamboyant style about this subject to make a deep impression on us. Satam Ninda, to criticize devotees, this is the first offense to the holy name. You want to chant Krishna's name and get the mercy of Krishna's name, but Krishna's name will not look at you if you criticize his devotees. That is not to what to speak of the great devotees. Even devotees are in difficulties and problems. Krishna said, Api chet sudaracharo bhajne mam ananya bhak sadar eva samantavya samyak vyavahito hi saha. Krishna said to Arjuna, even if a person who is dedicated to serving me does something terrible, duracha means terrible activity, and suduracha means most terrible of terrible activities. In the commentary, Srila Vishwanathar Thakur gives a list. I don't even want to remember that list. Terrible things. So, but still, Bhajate Mam Ananya Bhak, if that person is not worshipping any devatas, this is the main thing. Ananya Bhak here doesn't mean that that devotee is completely pure and only absorbed in Krishna 24 hours a day. It means that he has faith in Krishna and only worships Krishna. He doesn't worship Kali, Durga, Shiva, Ganesh, Rahu, Ketu, Shani Dev. Understand? Only Krishna. Shada Shabde, Vishwas Kahe, Sulida Nishjai, Krishna Bhakti Kaila, Sarvakama Krita Hoy. Faith means the unflinching conviction that only by serving Krishna I have fulfilled all other responsibilities. Nothing else to do. If Krishna is served like watering the root of a tree, all the leaves get the benefit. So if Krishna has been served, then all the devatas have been more than satisfied. So Apichat Sudarate Bhajate Mam Ananya Bhak Sadur Eva Samantavya. Arjuna said, but what if some one of your devotees does this or this? Krishna said, Sadur Eva Samantavya. No, you should consider him a sadhu. Samyak Vyavahito Hi Saha, because his determination is pointing in the right direction. He's on the path, one-pointed, going towards the goal of life. Then Arjuna said, but how can you be a sadhu? Krishna's eyes became red. No. Chipram bhavati dharmatma shashvam shantim nigacchati. Though he may have some fault today, but if he will continue on the path of bhakti, very quickly he'll become purified. Arjuna said, well, maybe we can say he's partially a sadhu, but he's not completely a sadhu. Then Krishna, his eyes became like fire, and he said to Arjuna, take a mardanga and cartels and go in the middle of the marketplace and beat them and loudly declare, Kaunti apratijanahi name bhakta pranashati. Hey Arjun, loudly declare that my devotee is never ruined, never lost, never vanquished. He is never overpowered and overcome by the material energy. Surely he will become successful. Then Arjun says, oh, okay. I accept. So Krishna has emphasized this so much in Bhagavad Gita. So if you want to progress in your spiritual life, be very liberal with others. If you want to be strict with yourself. And be very liberal and kind and respectful to everyone else. So, on this day, we are remembering the mercy of Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur and how he has beautifully presented the pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with these essential teachings, which are vital for us to assimilate so that our spiritual life will become successful. So Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Thakur used to say, when a person first comes to the mat, they should read Chaitanya Bhagavat. Read. This is the first thing. Just read Chaitanya Bhagavat. He said, it is so beautiful that even atheists, even meat eaters and others, when they read the pastimes of Sri Sri Gaur Nithai, their hearts will melt and they will weep tears of love. Vrindavan Das Thakur ki jai, tadi avivar titi mohotsav ki jai, om premanande. Now come to Bhajan Rahasya. We are on the second chapter. Verse 6. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is quoting some verses from the first canto, 7th chapter of Srimad Bhagavatam, describing the experience of Srila Vyasadeva. So it's very appropriate. Today is the appearance day of Vyasadeva in Gaura Lila. So, Srila Vyasadeva was instructed by his guru Narada Muni to go into trance, because even though Srila Vyasadeva had manifested the four Vedas, the Vedas were there, but it was just a collection of many, many matters. He divided them into four parts: Rig Veda, Sama Veda, Yajurveda, and Atharva Veda. And he manifested the Vedanta Sutra, the explanation of the essence of the Vedas. He manifested the Mahabharata, the great epic, and within that, Bhagavad Gita. He manifested 18 Puranas also. But having done all this, Srila Vyasadeva was not satisfied in his heart. So his Gurudev came to him, he said, the reason is this, because you have not elaborately described the beautiful Vrindavan pastimes of Sri Krishna and the glories of his loving associates. So you can see, if you study Bhagavad Gita, you can get some knowledge, but your heart will not be satisfied, because there is no description of the beautiful Vrindavan pastimes of Krishna there. So Narada Rishi blessed him to go into trance, and so that is described here. Bhakti yogi amanasi samyak pranite malay apasrat purusha punam miyam chatar apasrayam. Srila Vyasadeva, by the power of bhakti yoga, manasi samyak pranite malay, his mind became completely in equilibrium. No chitta vrittis, no oscillation at all. And there in his pure mind, Amala, immaculate consciousness, by the mercy of Narada Rishi, Samvit and Ladini came there and revealed to him the beautiful pastimes of Sri Krishna. How Krishna was born in Gokul to Mother Yashoda. How he was growing very naughty, stealing butter. How he killed Putana, Trinavarta, Shakatasur. Agasur. How he danced on the head of Kaliya. How he saved the Brijbasis by lifting up Giriraj Govardhan. How he danced in Rasalila with the Brajgopis. How one day a Krura came and took him to Mathura and he killed Kamsa Maharaj. All Mathura Lila and Dwarka Lila. Sila Vyasadeva saw it in his trance. It was spontaneously manifest. And Mayancha Tad Apasrayam. And he also saw Maya. And in he saw the Jivas also, us souls. Anarto Pasamam Sakshat Bhakti Yoga Matoksaje Lokasya Janato Vidvans Chakre Satvata Sanghitam. He saw that the living entities in Maya, they were covered by anartha. Many attachments, ignorance, desires. And because of this, they were suffering lifetime after lifetime. And he realized that the description of the pastimes of Krishna, by if those living entities who are in Maya simply hear this, they will be transferred from Maya to the pastimes of Krishna. Anugrahaya bhaktanam manasam dayam asrita tadushi krido yasudva tatparo bhavet. And he wrote that when Krishna comes into this world in his very beautiful human-like form, he performs astonishing pastimes. And if a person will listen to them, yasudva tatparo bhavet, they must become absorbed into them. So that does not mean that when you hear the pastimes of Krishna that you just become absorbed in remembering. It means that you, your soul in your spiritual form become absorbed into the Leela itself. Transferred from the material world to the spiritual world simply by the hearing process. By hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, and in the last verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, he said, Nama Sankirtanam Yasya Sarva Papa Pranashanam Pranamo Dukha Shamanas Tam Namami Harim Param. All glories to the Harinam Sankirtanam, which destroys all suffering of the living entities. I bow down to that Supreme Lord Hari. So two things here, Trinada Pisunijana, bow down and chant the holy names. One may say, why hear the pastimes of Krishna? Because by chanting the holy name, you can get liberation very easily. But to get bhakti, then some special relationship is there. So by hearing the pastimes of Krishna, then that nourishes our special relationship with Krishna. So we can not only be liberated and go to Vaikuntha, but attain a particular role in his Vrindavan Leela. So, if a person only worships God, they can go to Vaikuntha. But to attain Vrindavan, by mood, you will have to follow in the footsteps, follow the paths of a resident of Vrindavan. So it's necessary to hear that Vrindavan Leela, and then one will follow an associate there, and then you can enter. Because in Vrindavan, no one knows that Krishna is God. Nanda Maharaj, Yashoda, they're worshipping Lord Narayan. Sometimes they call their son, come on, it's a time for aarti, and Krishna's ahead in the aarti. But he can't wait to go out and play with his friends. So they worship Narayan, but they don't know that their son is God. But why are they worshipping Narayan? You should never worship the Supreme Lord for anything for yourself. But they are like a materialistic person in this world is praying to God for the benefit of their family. So then they show that they pray to Narayan. Oh, our son has become so restless, he's going to the house of the neighbor stealing butter. Please help him become more peaceful and well behaved. Give your blessing. Oh Narayan, give your blessing to our naughty boy. So Vrindavan is like this. As long as you think you have this mood to Krishna that he's God, you cannot go there. Lord Brahma went there, but he had to leave. Indra went there, he had to leave. Buddha went there, he had to leave. Akura went, he also had to leave. Anyone who comes to Vrindavan, but thinks, oh, Krishna is Bhagavan, they cannot stay. Therefore, not only chanting Harinam, but one should hear Srimad Bhagavatam, the pastimes of Krishna, so that one can become inspired to follow in the mood of the residents of Vrindavan. And then one can go beyond Vaikuntha. The holy name will take you beyond Vaikuntha to Vrindavan. So, here, it is said, Anato Pasamam Sakshat. Srila Vyasadeva saw the living entities in this world are covered by anartha. And by practicing bhakti, those anarthas can be removed and they can be transferred to the spiritual world. So, after giving this philosophical introduction, now Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur will describe in text 7, Mayamuk dasya jivasya geyo nartas tatua vidha hridur bhalyam chaparadho satrishna tatva vibramaha. There are four types of anarthas, four types of internal obstacles that must be overcome by the practice of bhakti, by the mercy of Guru and Krishna. So these four anarthas are tattva vibram, or tattva bram means the bewilderment or mistaken misunderstanding of tattva. Misunderstanding of tattva, philosophical principles. Then, asatrishna, being thirsty for temporary things. Aparad, making offenses. And hridoy darbalya, some weakness of heart. So now, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur will explain that each of these four obstacles has four types as well. So we'll go through them. First of all, Swarup Brahm or Tattva Brahm. This has four types. The first one is called Jiva Swarup Brahm. Misunderstanding in regard to Jiva Swarup. What is the soul? Soul is the Anu Chaitanya, minute particle of conscious energy, Krishna's Tatastha Shakti, marginal potency. And by constitution, every soul is the servant of Krishna. But many people think that the soul is actually one with Brahman. There is only one truth, that is light, and that is me. And I will be liberated and enter into that light and realize that I am the supreme reality. So this type of misunderstanding is called Tattva Brahm. If you practice bhakti but with this misunderstanding, then it will not bear the fruit. Because there will be present the desire for liberation, which is very, very antagonistic to the spirit of devotion. We see many persons that do kirtan, but because they have this mistake, this misunderstanding, they're doing bhakti to get liberation. And so their so-called bhakti is not bhakti at all. It looks like bhakti, but it is all offensive. So first one, Jiva Swarup Brahm. Then the second one, Paratattva Brahm. Understanding what is the Paratattva, the Supreme Truth. Supreme Truth is the personality of Godhead. That is not me or you or anyone else. He is distinct and he is Sarvashaktiman. He has all potencies, inconceivable potencies. And he is Rasabdhim. He is the ocean of Rasa. So, if a person thinks that the various demigods are equal to the Supreme Lord, or that all the demigods, they're all one, then they will also make offenses and they cannot progress in bhakti. So Paratattva Brahm means Ekale Ishwar Krishna Arasabha Britya Yari yaiche nichai sitaichi korinitya. There is one supreme controller, Ishwaraha Paramaha Krishna. That is Krishna, and all others are his servants. Even his own expansions. Balaram is his first expansion, but he is a servant of Krishna. So then, the third one is called Sadhya Sadhana Tattva Brahma. Misunderstanding of the truth of Sadhya and Sadhana. What is the goal of life? And what is the methodology to achieve it? Some persons think that I have to follow all the rules and regulations of Varnashram Dharma. That means their practice of bhakti is mixed with karma. Some persons think I have to focus on developing philosophical knowledge. So, the sadhana, all the truths of sadhana are there in Harina. And transcendental knowledge should come as the side effect. Vasudeve Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojitaya Dhyaniyasyasu Vairagyam Jnanam Chaya Dhoitukam. The ability to discriminate between matter and spirit, between the self and the body, all this type of jnana, it comes automatically as this incidental side effect of the practice of bhakti. So, the sadhya is not mukti liberation. The sadhya is not to attain Krishna or Radha or Radha and Krishna. The sadhya is what?
Prem.
Prem. Maputot. Krishna sambandha. Bhakti abhideya. Prem prayojan. Our relation is with Krishna. Our method of our sadhana is bhakti, and the prayojan is love. Krishna na nachaya prem bhakta nachaya apani nachaya tina nachaya katai. Prem makes Krishna dance, prem makes the devotee dance, and prem itself is like a third person, all three dance together. So prem is supreme. Love is supreme. In Srimad Bhagavatam, in the Rasalila, it is said that Rasutsava Sampravito Gopi Mandala Manditaha. That then the Rasalila began. The festival of Ras began. It doesn't say Krishna began the Rasalila. It said the Rasalila began. Yogeshwarena Krishnena Tasam Madhya Dvayor Madhya. Krishnena means by Krishna. Krishna was dancing in the midst of gopis. And Krishna here, Krishnena, Yogeshwarena Krishnena, is in the instrumental case. That means that Krishna was not doing this Rasalila. He was just an instrument. And Rasalila, that means Prem personified, was doing everything. And Krishna became helpless. He was like a puppet, being controlled by Prem. So how great is Prem? So that is the goal. So then the next is called Bhajan Virodhi Vishay Brahm. Misunderstanding in regard to the things which obstruct our bhajan. So some persons may think that a certain practice, this will help my bhajan or this practice, but actually these things are obstacles. If I artificially try to remember Astakali Lila, they think this is very good, but this is an obstacle. They're creating more and more vikalpa. And not having faith and shelter in the holy name, taking shelter of their mind. They will not progress. So, there are many types of misunderstanding in regard to bhajan. Some persons think, oh, if I will dress up like a gopi, then it will help me get gopi bath. Sakibeki Sampradaya. But Jiva Sadak Rupena Siddha Rupena Chatrahi. One has to follow the six Goswamis in outer form, and one can follow the residents of Vrindavan only internally, by mind. So there are different misunderstandings, and these all have to be cleared. So these are four types of Swarup Brahm misunderstanding that have to be removed by listening, by associating with Vaishnavas and hearing carefully for them. These will go. Then, the next anartha, asat trishna, the thirst for temporary things. These are also four types. Ai keshvasana para trikeshu chasana shubha bhuti vancha vimukshu cha yasat trishna chaturvidha. The first type of thirst for temporary things is a desire for objects of this material world. What do you want? A big house with a swimming pool and a Lamborghini. The thirst for worldly things. Then, two, the second, the desire for, person thinks, oh, this world is very temporary and short, but if I could live for thousands of years in Swargalok, then I could enjoy in the court of Indra. So, the desire for heavenly pleasures. That is the second type of asat trishna. Then, the third type, for yoga siddhis. The desire to get mystic powers, anima, lagima, mahima, ganima, kama, vasayita, to become lighter than air, to become the heaviest, to become the smallest, to be able to control another person's mind and body, to attain, take whatever you want from anywhere in the universe. All these various yoga siddhis come as the side effects of the Ashtanga Yoga sadhana. So to be greedy for these things, this also has to be given up. And the fourth asat trishna is the desire for liberation. Even desiring for nirvana, mukti, moksha, to become out of the cycle of birth and death. For what reason? For yourself, you're thinking. But this is no benefit to anyone. Just like a stone. If you put stone in water, but it cannot feel the water. So when a person enters into Brahman, then there is the Chiputi Vinash. There's no duality between subject-object. The knower, the method of knowing, and the object of knowledge. These three things are dissolved, so there's no experience there. So, the desire for liberation is selfish, very selfish, because it denies the existence of God. You don't want to serve God. Oh, this world is illusion. Okay, even if it's an illusion, then where did the illusion come from? So, impersonalism is a very mukti vancha. The desire for liberation is kaitava pradhan, the main form of cheating, because it's denying everything. It's very important to understand why impersonalism is completely impossible. First of all, they say everything is one. Only Brahman is true. So we have four questions for these, those who have such an opinion. The first one is, okay, if only Brahman is true, then who is in illusion? This is, who is the subject of illusion? So are you saying that Brahman is in illusion? So then that means there must be something more powerful than Brahman to be in illusion. But then someone may say, oh, no, not all of Brahman in this illusion, just a part is in illusion. Brahman has no parts. It is indivisible. It has no qualities, so it is nirvishesh. So it cannot, they have a part in illusion, a part which is liberated, and the one part will join with the other part. So this is all impossible. So the first thing is, who is in illusion? So you cannot answer. Then the second question, if by a miracle Brahman could be in illusion, then what is he confused about? What is the object of illusion? Because you told me there's nothing other than Brahman, so there'd be nothing for Brahman to be in illusion about. to be confused, to make a mistake. Because they say that, just as if you in the dark you see a snake but you think it's a rope. So in the same way the material world is an illusion like that. It is not real. So, but when you see a snake in the dark, and you think it's a rope, there has to be a real snake to make the mistake in the first place. And there has to be a similarity between the two things which you are mistaking. So our third question is, okay, if the material world is just illusion, it's just a mistake, but the reality is Brahman, what is the similarity between Brahman and the world? What is the similarity? Similarity is no similarity at all. There cannot be anything similar between that which is nirvishesh, having no characteristics, and that which is full of characteristics. So that is, and then the fourth question is, let us accept for argument's sake that there is some similarity between, you can mistake Brahman for the world and be an illusion. So if they are so similar and you can mistake one for the other, that means that you could also mistake the world for Brahman by accident. So just as you accidentally mistaken Brahman for the world and you are an illusion, then you can also accidentally mistake the world for Brahman. And then everyone could just become enlightened by accident. So why are you doing any sadhana? Why? So, in this way, Mayavad, impersonalism is all completely ignorant and foolishness. And the desire for liberation is cheating, because we are the servants of Krishna and it is denying our own identity. Now, the next type of anartha also has four types, that is aparad, offense. Krishna nama surupeshu tadiya chitkaneshu cha jaya buddha gane nityam aparadas chaturvidha. There are four types of offenses. Rad means satisfaction. And apa means that which, its prefix means going away. That which drives away the satisfaction of God is called aparad. By which we fail to satisfy the Supreme Lord is aparad. So there are four types. First, there are the offenses to Krishna Nam, which as you know, there are 10 offenses to the Holy Name. Then, Krishna Swarup, offenses in serving the deity. In Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, you can see there is a description of 32 types of seva aparad. 32 offenses we can make in serving the deity. Then, the next type is tadiya aparad. That means offenses to those things that belong to Krishna, which means Giriraj Govardhan, Jamuna, Ganga, the holy Dham, and especially also Tadiya, who belong to Krishna, his devotees. Then the fourth type of offense is Chitkana, offenses to any living entity. Don't give pain or difficulty to anyone, not even to an ant. It will make some obstacle in your progress. Then, the fourth type of anartha also has four types. Tuja sakti kuti nati matsarayam swapatistata hridar balyam budai shaswat geyam kila chaturvidam. So these are four types of obstacles which are in the category of Hridai Durbalya, weakness of heart. So the first one, Tucha Sakti, being attached to worthless objects.
estar apegado a
petty things of this world, but we become attached to them and they feel, they occupy our mind. Tucha asakti. Then, kutinati. Kutinati means hypocrisy, deceit. So a person, they may act as if they are very devoted outside, but inside they have other desires and they try to hide their bad behavior from others. So a devotee should always be very open-hearted. If you have some problem, go to your Gurudev, go to your senior Vaishnavas and open your heart. Don't hide it. And then just by confessing and expressing, you will see that you will overcome this problem by Guru's mercy and Vaishnava's mercy. My Gurudev used to say, just as if you have cancer, I will hide it. No, if you hide it, it will spread and it will kill you. So if we have some weakness, we hide it due to duplicity, then that weakness will kill us. So we go to a sadhu vaidya, a doctor, who can make a heart operation and cut it out. So, kutinati. Perhaps you know, see, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he had one associate named Chota Haridas. Chota Haridas was a vairagi in the renounced order of life. He was a very beautiful singer. Mahaprabhu liked to hear his kirtan. So one day, one Vaishnava named Bhagavan Acharya, he said, oh, go to the house of Madhavi and beg some rice there. So he went there and he begged some rice. Madhavi is the old sister of Shiki Mahiti. She was very old, about 84 years old. She was a Parang Bhagavat, very high level of pure Vaishnavi. Not an ordinary devotee. Param Bhagavat. And Tapasvini, she was very austere and old. And he went there and he begged some rice from her, then he put it back. So it was prepared and given to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was tasting, oh, where is this rice from? Govinda said, his servant said, oh, Chota Haridas has collected it, he went to beg from Madhavi. Then Mahaprabhu said, don't allow him to come here anymore. I don't want to see him. Prabhu kahi prakriti sambhasan dekhite na paro ami tarabadan. Mahaprabhu said that if someone in the renounced order will be alone with a woman and talking, then I cannot see his face. I cannot tolerate him. So Mahaprabhu rejected Chota Haridas. So then Chota Haridas was devastated. He waited for some time. Even the devotees, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, Srop Damodar, Rai Ramananda, they are just, you wait. Mahaprabhu will, now he is angry, but later he'll be merciful and he'll accept you again. But a long time passed and Mahaprabhu never accepted. Even the associates of Mahaprabhu begged, oh, he's very sorry, it was a small thing. So, just let him. Mahaprabhu said, no, don't ask me. Otherwise, I'll leave you also. I'll go to Alana, to Brahmagiri. So then, no one said anything. So then, that Chota Haridas, he left and he went to Prayag, to the Triveni, where Ganga and Jamuna meet. And there, he drowned himself in the river. So then afterwards, some pilgrims came to Puri and they informed Mahaprabhu, oh, Chota Haridas has given up his life. Then Mahaprabhu heard this, he was very satisfied. Good. This is a correct punishment. Atonement, not punishment, prasita, atonement for what he has done. Then all devotees became very afraid. But very, very careful in their association. So be careful. असत्संग त्याग यही वैष्णव आचार। स्त्री संगी कृष्ण भक्त दिस एसोसिएशन असत्संग इज ऑफ टू टाइप्स। The behavior of a Vaishnava can be understood by how he gives up asatsanga. How can we recognize a Vaishnava? A Vaishnava is that person who gives up the association which is asat. So two types of asatsanga. Stri Sangi, one who associates with women in an inappropriate way. If someone is married, they can be with their family, this is okay. But those with whom we are not married and those who are single, they should not mix closely together at all. Very, only bare minimum, what is required to do service. Not more than that. And we know, to be honest, we know how much that is. Not much, very little. And if someone will try to associate more than that, because some desire is in the heart, this is kutinati. Understand duplicity. Now, cheating, being dishonest with oneself and with others. So, one day, Mahaprabhu was at the shore of the ocean. And the devotees, they were coming. And they could hear a very beautiful, beautiful voice. And what was it? It was the voice of Chota Haridas. And he was singing kirtan. And Mahaprabhu was listening to his kirtan and he was rushing. And one devotee said, oh, Chota Haridas, he committed suicide, so he must have become a Brahma Rakshasa. He became some kind of ghost. And now his ghost is here. So Damodar said, that's impossible. He was a devotee of Mahaprabhu and always singing the holiness, always doing kirtan. So he must have attained his spiritual form. And so this is true. By this pastime, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was taught so many things. First of all, Chota Haridas is Mahaprabhu's eternal associate. So he cannot make a mistake. But sometimes Mahaprabhu uses his associates to teach us what to do. And sometimes he uses his associates to teach us what not to do. So, through Chota Haridas, he is shown what not to do. Don't have duplicity. Don't transgress the etiquette of Vaishnava behavior. One time, Mahaprabhu, he heard some Devadas, he was singing a beautiful song of Gita Govinda. He became in a trance and he just ran towards where that singing was coming from to embrace that person. Oh, I cannot repay you for putting this nectar in my ears. Sita Kamala Kuta Mandala Rita Kundala Rita Kundala Kalita Lalita Banumala Jayo Jayo Devahari Hare Hare Jayo Jayo Devahari. The Mahaprabhu was mad and he went running. But then Govinda saw that this person singing was a dancing girl from the Jagannath temple who was in the forest. And he tried to run after Mahaprabhu, but Mahaprabhu was very big and very fast. He could not catch him. So then Govinda called, Stri! Stri means woman. Means Stri in Sanskrit means who expands. Who expands the field of worldly activities. Because when you are a bachelor, then you just sleep on the floor, sleeping bag anywhere. Yeah. You don't need anything. But then afterwards, when you get married, then you need a house and a dog and a car and everything. And then expands. This goes to expands the field of material activities. So, another word for female in Sanskrit is pramada. Pramada means inattentiveness. As soon as some attraction comes, you can attend, you are completely inattentive. So, another word for woman in Sanskrit, yoshit. Yoshit means upon seeing whom desires to enjoy the mature world rise up in the heart. Sanskrit is a very interesting language. So ladies, don't take offense. This goes both ways. Whatever is said this way, I'm only saying it that way. You can flip it and it applies the other way also. So, Mahaprabhu was running, Govinda was running behind, he couldn't catch and he shouted, "Shri!" And then that sound pierced the ears of Mahaprabhu and he came to his senses. "Oh Govinda, you saved my life." Because if I had gone a little further and if I would have touched her, then I would kill myself. When the devotees heard this, they all became afraid. So, Mahaprabhu, apani karima bhakta bhava ankari, apani achari bhakti shikamu savari. Krishna has taken the form of a devotee to teach us about the path of devotion by his own activities. So, by this pastime of Chota Haridas, Mahaprabhu has taught so many things. First of all, how much he loves his devotee. Because that devotee attained his divine spiritual form and he was coming and serving Mahaprabhu by singing beautiful kirtan. No one else could see it, but Mahaprabhu and Chota Haridas were relishing their loving relationship. And one day some devotees heard some sound. What is that? How much Mahaprabhu loves his devotee. And another teaching here, how much the devotee loves Mahaprabhu. That not having Mahaprabhu's association, he could not stay alive even. He could not consider, my whole life I will not see Mahaprabhu. What is the use of this life? So the attachment of the devotee. Another teaching, the obvious teaching. Yadi chau pranai rakite gaurangena sane. Chota haridasa kata takijena mani. Srila Jagannatha Pandit said, if you want to have love and affectionate relationship with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, always remember the history of Chota Haridas. So be careful in terms of association. You can spoil your spiritual life and become completely entangled for many lifetimes. Be careful. Chota Haridas Katha Take Jaya Namani. Always keep it in your mind. Another teaching here is the power of the Dham. Because Prayag, Ganga and Jamuna meet there. So by the power of the holy place, he attained liberation. So many teachings are there in this pastime of Chota Haridas. Mahaprabhu himself, he was very, very careful. Once, there was a little boy and he used to come to see Mahaprabhu, and Mahaprabhu would play with him, talk to him about Krishna, and the little boy became very attached to Mahaprabhu. And every day he used to come. One day Damodar Pandit said, "Oh, you are, oh Goswami," he said to Mahaprabhu very boldly, "Oh Goswami, we will soon see what a Goswami you are. How your senses are controlled. You are a Pandit, Parupadesh Pandit." That means, who is learned at giving instructions to others. Mahaprabhu thought, what is he saying? Damodar Pandit said, look, this boy is the son of one Brahmin widow. And she is very good, she is very well behaved, but she only has two faults. One, she's a woman, and two, she's beautiful. So, if you are very loving and always playing with this child, what will everyone think? They will think that you have some relation with that very young and beautiful Brahmini widow. And the rumors in Kali Yuga, they spread like wildfire everywhere. Then no one will have any trust in you. So Mahaprabhu, he considered this. There are many teachings in this pastime also. Mahaprabhu is showing how one should be careful to do the right thing, also to be seen to do the right thing, even. And on the other hand, Damodar Pandit, he had so much love for Mahaprabhu, he was so concerned about him that he could speak very boldly and even correct him. But really, Mahaprabhu is senior to him, so he should not have tried to correct him in that way. It was not fully appropriate. So afterwards, Mahaprabhu sent him away from Jagannath Puri. But where did he send him? Navadvipa. So in one sense, he sent him away to teach us, oh, someone should not speak out of turn to their seniors. But on the other hand, he was also very merciful to him. And he said, I want you to go and stay with my mother, Sachimata. Stay there in Navadvip and just protect her. Because you are impartial. You are nirapeksh. This is very important. If someone is impartial, they can speak the truth. Even if there's a difficult situation, they can speak the truth. But if someone has partiality, then a person who is partial cannot protect the people around them because they have rose-colored spectacles. Yeah? And when there's some danger or problem, oh, it's a no problem, no problem. And then everything is spoiled. So in this way, Mahaprabhu teaches so many subtle things through his own life and through the lives of his associates. So, here, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is describing Hridaya Durbalya, four types of weakness of heart, Tucha Sakti, attachment to worthless objects, Kutinati, duplicity, third one, Matsarya, means becoming jealous, becoming envious on seeing the prosperity of others. If someone else is becoming very successful in their life, they're progressing in bhakti, or others are honoring them, giving them respect, and then the heart is burning, ah, like a fire. Why are they not respecting me? Why respecting this person? Matsarya, envy comes. The word matsarya, envy, in Sanskrit comes from the word matsya, means fish. Because in a lake of water, if there's a fish there, big fish, he sees the small fish and doesn't want the small fish to grow up and be a big fish like him, so oh. So this is the mentality of a fish, matsarya, jealousy, envy towards others, hostility. So all enmity should be given up. If you see a devotee who is more qualified, then you should be very happy. Why? We can only advance by the association of more qualified devotees. What do we need in our life? We need to have the association of persons who are more qualified than ourselves. If we'll be with them, then we'll also become more qualified. So to see a more qualified person is not a problem. It is not something we should become angry about and burning inside with jealousy. It is how fortunate I am. And the wonderful thing is that when we honor a person, then it builds a bridge between their heart and our heart, and all their good qualities march over and come to us. Whomever you respect, whomever you honor, you transform and become like them. So this is wonderful. On the other hand, if we criticize someone, then we also build a bridge between their heart and our heart, and all their bad qualities come to us. And the very thing that you are criticizing, you see, after a few days, you are doing the same thing, or worse. And if you criticize someone and that bad quality actually is your mistake, they don't have a bad quality at all, then twice as much reaction will come if that devotee is innocent. And if they're guilty, if they're really doing something wrong and you point it out, then still the bad quality comes. So be very, very cautious, very careful. So Hridaya Durbalya, the third type, is Matsarya, envy upon seeing the prosperity of others. Then four is Patishtahasa, the desire for prestige and position. bhakti has to be motivated by one thing. How can I make Krishna happy? How can I please Gurudev? Vaishnavas, they are the associates of Krishna. By this, Krishna is very pleased. But if that service tendency becomes mixed with, if I do this, everyone will respect me. And now that becomes the driving force, your motivation. And working very, very hard so everyone will see what I have done. Then, no benefit from those activities. Very, very sad. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is giving one example. Text 21. Kristasa tristas opachara manire nidipatet katham sadhu premnas prachari sujraitan nanamana sadatam seva sva prabhuda ita samantam atulam itatam niskasyata itam itam beshayati sa. The desire for pratishtha, to be honored in this world, is like a dog eating prostitute. And she's dancing in the heart. That means a very low class, disgusting, sinful person is living in the heart and dancing there. So, katam sadhu premas prashati sucretam nanamana. How can love, which is pure, come and reside in the heart with that dog eating prostitute? Not possible. But sarvana tapeya, it is, one may be able to give up all other anartas, but this anarta of the desire to be honored, worshipped, respected by others is very, very difficult to give up. For the conditioned souls, actually they have no strength to do it. So Srila Raghunath Das Goswami says in this verse, Sadatam seva sva prabhu daita samantam atulam. There are some devotees, like our Gurudev, our Acharyas, our six Goswamis, and they are like generals in the army of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. They are very, very powerful. And if one will call out to them, oh please, Rupa Goswami Pad, oh Srila Natam Das Thakur, oh Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, oh Gurudev, please save me, then they will come and they will throw that dog-eating prostitute out of the heart. And then Krishna Prem can appear. So only by the mercy of the association of great devotees can one overcome this contamination. Remember, we're in the second chapter. The second chapter is on the subject of Sadhu Sangha, Bhajana Kriya and Anartha Nivritti. The anarthas are, we are purified of anarthas by, especially by association of powerful devotees. Without them, we cannot overcome our weaknesses. So, Srila Raghunath Das Goswami, he has prayed very beautifully. He said, Yad, Yatna tha samadamatma viveka yoga adyatna lagnam avikarma bund manome rupasya tad smitamukam sadayavalokam asadya madhyati haras charita idhanim. I tried to control my mind, but it was impossible. But I associated again and again with Srila Rupa Goswami. Srila Rupa Goswami told very beautiful Harikatha, very beautiful Siddhanta, and by listening to him again and again, taking his advice on how to chant, how to remember, how to do bhajan, then yadyatnata samadamatma viveka yoga. By his hard endeavors, he tried again and again, and gradually he taught me samadama, how to control my senses and how to control my mind. Atma viveka yoga. by his association listening the vivek, discrimination between myself and what is not the self was awakened. Adhyatma lagnam avikara vabun manome. And my mind became nirvikar. No oscillation, no modification or disturbance in my mind. And I could apply my mind in hearing, chanting and remembering and serving in all ways. So my mind became very peaceful by his merciful endeavors and instructions and association. And then what happened? When my mind was very peaceful, rupasya tatsmitam sudham sadaya avalokay. Then simply by his beautiful smile and by his merciful glance, now my heart has become maddened, intoxicated with the beautiful qualities of Sri Krishna and his pastimes. So Raghunath Das Goswami is expressing here how gradually by association we conquer our mind and senses, our discrimination comes, and then by the merciful glance and smile of a pure devotee, the pastimes of Krishna appear in the heart and we become captivated now by that. So, Eichai Gosai Kori Charana Bandhan Jahoite Bigna Nash Abhista Puran. Srila Narottama Thakur has said also, Eichai Gosai Kori Charana Bandhan, by praying to the six Goswamis. Remember, he came to Vrindavan. He was taking Shiksha from Srila Jiva Goswami part directly. So he said, by remembering the Goswamis and praying to them, Jahoiti Bignanash, all the obstacles in spiritual life, they are washed away. Abhishtapuran, and my heart's desire become fulfilled. So Raghunath Das Goswami prayed, Abhir Pali Patiputa Kanta Dasa Bilasa Tibalasavara Sri Rupa Chintamala Sapti Sangsto Matswanta Durdanta Hayestrastam. He said that Abhira. Abhira is one jati, one subcaste within the cowherd people. So Abhira Pali, there is a village of Abhiras. And that village is called Dandagaon. Dandagaon is Abhira Pali, the village of the one particular type of cowherders. Abhira Pali Pati. There is the king or protector of that place, Nanda Maharaj. Abhira Pali Pati Putra. And he has a son. Abhira Pali Pati Putra Kanta. And his son, Nanda Nanda, has Kanta, a secret beloved. So, Abhira Pali Pati Putra Kanta means Radhika. Very sweet. Madhur naam. Abhir Pali Patiputra Kanta Dasa Bilasa. The desire for the service of that Radhika. Atibala. Not only desire, Atibala. Extremely strong, powerful desire. Asparvara is like a asvabara, means a jockey, you know, who rides a horse. Someone who rides a horse is asvabara. So there is one horse rider. What is that? Si rupa chintamala sapti sangsto. The remembrance of the spotless qualities of Srila Rupa Goswami. The spotless contemplation of Rupa Goswami himself. How is Rupa Goswami? Oh, sitting in the forest, in Terakadamba, chanting the holy names, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And he's absorbed in remembering the sweet pastimes of Radha and Krishna. Linam nikunja kurai bhavatim mukunde Chitraeva suchiravati ruchiraksinaham Bhugnam brumam narachi eti mirsham rushantam Tagrei barjanda tanayasya kadarunasya Rupa Goswami is in trance. And he sees, oh, I am Rupa Manjari. Oh, with Lalita, Vishakha and other Sakis. Radhika is hiding in one kunj. And we are together in the forest waiting. Krishna came there, arrived there. Oh, where is Radhika? So then the Sakhi said, she's over there. Krishna quickly ran and entered the kunj, and when he got inside, no one was there. Then he realized, the Sakhis are giving me the runaround. They're playing with me. So then Krishna came out from the kunj, and Lalita and other Sakhis, they're all there and laughing. Politely covering their mouths. What a murka. Then Krishna came. He said, please tell me, where is Radhika? Another Sakhi said, don't worry, she's there. Krishna quickly ran, breathlessly. Looked inside. Oh, not again. He came out. This is called seva. How to increase Krishna's eagerness? This will make his because the more eager he is, the more joy will be there in meeting. So the Sakhis, they're doing seva. How to increase Krishna's eagerness? So then, see, Krishna came back. Will someone please kindly tell me where Radhika is? Everyone was, no, no, we're not going to tell you. Except for Chitrasakhi. Chitrasakhi is very soft. So she felt sorry for Krishna. She didn't say anything. She said, no, no, no. And by her eyebrows she indicated. Krishna was very grateful to Chitrasakhi from Chiksoli, you know? She's from the village of Chiksoli. So then Krishna went to that kunj where Radhika was. Now this time Rupa Manjari knew, oh, he's going to the right place. So perhaps Radha and Krishna, they may need my services. So when Krishna went, then Rupa Manjari followed, and she came and she waited outside the kunj. Then Krishna went inside and met with Radhika. There was a very beautiful meeting. Rupa Manjari was very fortunate to look through the Jalarandra, through the lattice of the Kunjagriha, Kunj Bhavan, and watch the beautiful meeting of Radha and Krishna. Then Radha and Krishna made themselves tidy, and then they came out from the kunj. But when Radharani came out, she saw Rupa Manjari. And even though she was delighted to meet with Krishna, but in front of her friends, she's always obstinate and shows that she's contrary. So said she looked at Rupa Manjari with frowning eyebrows. Oh, why did you tell him where I was hiding? Expressing her objections. This is the nature of prem. Very. Vibhara kalyan sadhana brindhim. Gurapi gaurava charya bhina. Mubhichir vakram api suddho. Jayati muradvishi radhikano raga. Radharani's love is all-pervading, but still increasing. How is it possible? It is the heaviest, most important, but with no pride at all. And though it's the most pure, her love is completely crooked. Aheri vagati prenas vavava kuti labhavet. Love moves in a crooked way like a snake. You know, if a snake wants to go in that direction, his head goes in this direction. And then that direction. Like this. He's going there, but his head is going there and there. So love moves like this. So Radhika came up. Oh, Rupa Manjari, why did you tell him where my hiding place was? Linam nikunja gore bhavatim mukunde chintayava suchiraviti ruchirakshinara. She's saying, oh Ruchirakshi, oh Radharani, whose eyes are full of taste, that means I know that you are very happy that Krishna found you. Naham, it was not me. Chitraya Vasu Chiravati. It was Chitrasakhi who by her glance told him where you were. So don't be angry with me, it's not my fault. And Krishna, I pray Brajanda Taniyasya Kadananese. Krishna is standing there and seeing Radhika and Rupa Manjari quarreling with each other. It's amazing for him. This is Rupa Goswami. So when Rupa Goswami is chanting the holy names and remembering Radha Krishna's separation from each other, then the trees start to cry and the flowers and leaves are falling from the trees around him. And then when you write a poem like this, how Radha Krishna are meeting, and it's so joyful, then by the influence of his mood, then all the trees, the flowers bloom again. So, Sirupa Jintavala Sapti Sangsto, the remembrance, the pure contemplation on the glories of Rupa Goswami is like one horse rider. And this horse rider is made of the Abir Pali Patiputa Kanta Dasa Bilasa Tibala, extremely strong Abilas desire to serve the lotus feet of Radharani. And my mind, Sri Rupa Chintavala Sapti Sangsto Matswanta Durdanta Hyastrastam, my mind is like a wild horse. Wild horse is very powerful. If you try to ride the horse, it goes everywhere. No one can control it. You try to pull the horse this way, it won't go, it will go the other way. So Srila Raghunath Das Goswami Pad is saying, my mind is like that, like a wild horse. How can it be controlled? But because I associated with Rupa Goswami, I am remembering the qualities of Rupa Goswami. How he is the embodiment of intense desire for the service of Radha and Krishna. So the remembrance of Rupa Goswami is like a very strong rider who gets onto the wild horse of my mind and controls it. And now it can gallop all the way to Goloka Vrindavan. So, we cannot control our own mind, our senses, the desire for pratishtha, become free from all of these anarthas, but by sadhu sangha, associating with pure devotees, praying to them, remembering them, their mercy will control our mind and we can make progress towards our goal of life.